guess I've got to say something after that really flattering introduction. It's a real pleasure for me to be here today. I'm flattered by what Patricia had to say, but actually, I've only two reasons for being well known. So the first of these is I share a name with a distinguished politician who was Taoiseach in Ireland three times, a somewhat absent-minded professor known as Garret the Good, prone to wearing odd shoes, speaking fluent French, memorizing Aeroflot timetables, and in many ways initiating the peace process. So if you have to share a name with somebody, it's a whole lot better than being called Richard Nixon or Charles Haughey. However, what has most consistently got me to the top of the restaurant queue is a rather disturbing physical similarity to John Cleese, which is remarked upon virtually every week, actually. So tonight, I don't feel at all famous, but rather humbled by the breadth of the contributions made by these awardees, both present and some who couldn't make it tonight. Their accomplishments are actually very striking, as you've heard. They range from discovery of the essential elements of life, Dr. Watson, to helping the most deprived in society, from devising innovative business models for delivery of healthcare, to discovery of new drugs, to shaping the education of future physicians and biomedical scientists. It's really an honor for me to be in your midst. So this is an opportunity to remember our cultural roots and how they may have contributed to what we are, or more broadly, how they might be harvested for the good of medicine and science. Like many of us, I suspect, I found myself provoked by and admiring of the recent debate in Scotland. On the one hand, the prospect of independence stirred me. Of course Scotland could go it alone. Of course the English would come to the table with their currency. And of course the Europeans would let them in. They were more than capable of running their own show. And the scaremongering of the aptly named No campaign and the opportunity to stick it to the Sassenachs appealed to the emotions of this Irishman. On the other hand, the Devo Max option, remaining within the UK, but now laden with the bribes of power and resources provided by the frightened Westminster politicians, appealed not so much to my heart as to my head. Particularly in biomedical science, I have continued to be impressed by how in the UK, unlike here, you can readily get four or six people in a room who cover the major sources of funding and policy and make enlightened choices. Such a contrast to the tortured predicament of science in this country at this time, where the NIH dollars in real terms have declined by more than 20% in the last 10 years. Within the UK, Scotland, rightly, in my view, has prioritized access to healthcare and education. And having rattled those politicians in Westminster, can now pursue with even greater vigor a course that serves as an exemplar for the rest. So I hoped for a clear, not a marginal answer. And the Scots delivered it with a level of civility in the run-up and rate of participation in the democratic process, which stands in stark contrast to the depressing tribalism all too evident in our political process in the United States. So why talk about our Celtic cousins on this occasion? We Irish in America are also part of something smaller and focused, which we treasure, and something much larger, which empowers us in Canada and in these United States. Like the Scots, we have a developed and a profound sense of our own identity, but it enhances rather than limits our contribution to the larger culture. Our roots give us our sense of irony, our humor, our resignation and doom, our love of music, river dancing, and above all, the talk, our way with words, our poetry, our inclination to sing. But they also give us a sense of compassion, a love for the underdog, a devotion to fairness. And these are the instincts and qualities so central to the values of the people in this room, intrinsic as they are to careers in medicine and science successfully pursued. These are the qualities that we bring to the pragmatism, to the focus, to the effectiveness of these blended societies in North America. A recent paper from Cologne, published in Science, highlighted the impact of moral contagion. If you suffer the goodness of others, you're likely to do good to others as the day unwinds. Mind you, if you do good, you now feel the moral license to do something not so good to others. So it's a sort of somewhat complicated issue. Some might say this is all biblically self-evident, but now we have the science to support it. So I'd like to think our Irish roots have contributed to the moral contagion in healthcare spread by the people in this room, so necessary as a counter to a world that suffers existential threats from climate change, religious violence, poverty, and infectious disease. So despite these challenges, we can bring to them our Irish humor, our irony, our way with words, blended with American pragmatism and optimism. The accomplishment of so many honorees today reflects such an effective blend, an Irish Uisce Beatha rather than a single malt, but with a shared sense of purpose, joy and discovery, and pursuit of the common good with our Scottish cousins. So reason enough, in the words of Monty Python, to always look on the bright side of life. Thank you.